Dear viewers and subscribers, welcome to Virtual Coffee with Jagadish in Pannika Tutorials YouTube channel. We have Mr. Shubham Panda, who is a founder of Zartup Company. He is with us to share his experience and knowledge with all the viewers. Thank you, Shubham, for accepting my request in your busy schedule. It is my pleasure to host you and have you in our channel.
Thank you so much, Jagadish, for inviting me to your podcast. Pleasure being here.
Can my viewers know about yourself and your educational background?
This is Shubham. I'm from Sambalpur, which is a tier 3 city based out of Odisha. I completed my engineering from Punjab Engineering College, which is based out of Chandigarh. And currently, I'm building Zartup, which is trying to disrupt the entrepreneurial ecosystem of India.
I see that you have done quite a good number of internships at various IITs and other platforms. Can you please explain the process of getting internship offers from IITs?
Sure. So actually, in my first semester itself, I started applying for internships. My first internship was at IIT Kharagpur in their aerospace engineering department. I used to work in the thermoelectric generator materials for the spacecrafts. So space science was something I was intrigued about. That's the reason why I tried doing a bunch of stuff and landed up in an IIT doing an internship. So the application process is pretty simple, reaching out to the professors directly through mails, the first one. Second one would be, there are like few portals, like IIT Bombay has this dedicated portals for applying for their internships. IIT Kharagpur had some international winter and summer term called as ISWT, which runs like every year. At that point of time, and now even it runs like every 6 months. So these are few portals which students can see if they are willing to get into an IIT for an internship.
Thank you, Shubham, for explaining the process in detail. How did this internship experience help you in engineering journey and also in your entrepreneurial journey?
During my internships, I learned a bunch of stuff. First of all, working on few projects gave me motivation to work hard in terms of 16 hours a day, 17 hours a day while I was working on building a project in IIT Bombay. So they motivated in a way to work hard, to achieve something, striving for the best. So these are few subjective stuffs that I learned from these internships in terms of how they helped me in my entrepreneurial journey. But my last internship was at JP Morgan before joining JP Morgan as a full-time employee. So that was something which helped me a lot in terms of getting a view of this corporate world, organizational structure, all sort of things, apart from the tech investment banking exposure, which I got working with US clients and all sort of things.
You have received several awards like Space Design Award, UAV Design Award, etc. Can my viewers know much about them?
As I mentioned before, I was like very much intrigued by space science from my childhood itself. So after getting into my college, the only reason why I went to a college in northern part of India, being from the eastern part of India myself, was I was intrigued about aerospace. And PEC was a college where I was getting a seat, and aerospace engineering department was there, though I didn't get that department in particular. So I thought of changing my branch in the later phases. So I joined PEC. And going forward, working on few projects inspired me to join a society called Astronomy and Space Physics Society, which I led in the later stages in my second year. So over there, I came to know across different competitions which are there. And we were the first team to participate in CAMSAT, which was a canister satellite competition hosted by NASA in Texas. We got like 41st rank while I was in my second year. And we used to work really hard, like 2 weeks continuously missing all the classes. We got some notice from the professors that you are not attending classes, but we are so much dedicated into that project. And finally, we got like 41st international rank over there and could manage to get good sort of laurels out of that. And apart from this competition, we went to a bunch of IITs, IIT BHU, Roorkee, IIT Kharagpur, Bombay, won several rewards over there as well in the same niche, that was space science and designing space shuttles, launching UAVs. So those were the bunch of stops that I was working in my first year and second year of college.
It is very good to hear, Shubham. Can you please share about your working experience?
In my first year and second year, it was space science which motivated me to work, worked on a bunch of college projects. Then I went to IIT Bombay for another aerospace engineering internship. And after that, I thought of exploring the corporate world in detail. So in my third year, I started preparing for JP Morgan's interview, which was the first company that was coming to our college. It was based out of finance, which I wasn't aware of at all. I had no knowledge in finance. There were folks who were preparing since last 2 years or 3 years. They just wanted to get this internship. But for me, it was just about implementing stuff which I learned before during my first year and second year, working hard and understanding the concepts rather than just doing bunch of stuff for the admin sake of it. Like I'm studying 16 hours or 17 hours a day, it doesn't matter if you don't understand the concept. So that was the thought process behind this. I started preparing for this internship just 15 to 20 days before the date in which the company was coming, because I was focusing on my projects before that. And so the first thing I did was talking to my seniors and understanding what are the questions which they ask. So focusing on the 80% of the things which matter and the 20% of the things that doesn't matter was away from my mind completely. So due to that, I was able to crack this internship opportunity at JP Morgan, first of all. And the work experience was pretty good. I like the culture over there, working with global clients. Then I joined JP Morgan right after my college. I worked there for 2 years, almost 2 years, in the technology investment banking space. We worked with few IPOs, few merger and acquisitions. So this was primarily my work experience in terms of investment banking.
How many startups did you work with and started till now?
Formally, I started after my third year, but in my 11th itself, I did a project for Google Science Fair called LAPS, Laser Assisted Accident Prevention System. So that was my first informal exposure to the startup world. The concept was pretty simple. I used to see lots of accidents happening in the national highway near which I live. And we planned to solve that by building a laser assisted model surrounding the cars by some infrared rays. And if two cars are coming closer, then a buzzer will be there and both the cars will stop. That was the primary motivation behind this. We created a whole business plan, pitched to a few investors. We became Asia finalists during that period of time when I was in 11. So this was the starting point. After that, I again got busy with the ITJE hot race and skipped this particular passion for a while. But after getting into college, and my first internship, which was at IIT Kharagpur, it was regarding thermoelectric generators. So by learning those thermoelectric materials, how they work, how they transform heat energy into electricity, I founded WonderGAD. That was my first startup formally. WonderGAD was solving a simple problem. I used to trek to the mountains, to the hilly areas a lot, and I used to get my batteries drained. So I wasn't able to capture beautiful photographs, wasn't able to call my home whenever it was required. To solve that problem, we came up with a very simple solution using thermoelectric materials, attaching thermoelectric generators below a bread can and using that as a container to cook food in the mountains. So whenever you cook food or boil water in that container, it will produce some electricity using which you can charge your phone. It's like having bonfire and charging your phone parallelly. So that was what my first startup was. Then I moved on to building MarketGAD, which was in the market research space. Started it in my fourth year of college, continued it during my job as well. And during that point of time, it was pretty simple, a service-based model, helping companies or startups across India to do market research. And we were trying to build something like Product Hunt for India as well, listing those startups, featuring them for them to gain traction. That was the second startup that I built. The third one was Juggler, which was into the computer vision-based fitness space. We exited that three, four months back right now. The problem that we are trying to solve with Juggler was primarily tracking fitness. So if you see, fitness tracking is very manual. You have to note down that you did 8 push-ups today, 20 squats yesterday, something like that. The apps which exist in the market are also very manual. We have to select a number, that 20 squats, 10 push-ups, something like that, which are not intuitive. So we tried to make it very much automatic, try to make it very much efficient so that you can keep your phone in front of you, turn on your cameras, and it will do everything, all sort of tracking for you. So that was what we were solving at Juggler, and now up to Zartup, which I'll explain later. But it's not just these four startups. It's like 30 or more than that failed startups that were that I do not talk about, which were just a landing page, launching it, working for 1 month, 2 months, which didn't work. So like that's how it works, I guess.
All your startup ideas are very interesting and useful for public. What are the struggles that you have faced while building a startup during your engineering time?
While I was in college, during my first startup, which was WonderGet, I went to few professors, few folks who were doing venture development sort of stuff, and they advised on doing an IP of the startup, first of all, patenting the idea. The second thing was registering a company. The third thing was creating a pitch deck, approaching to investors. None of them talked about validating an idea in a lean way. None of them talked about what is the problem you are solving. Does that problem matter in the world or not? None of them talked about if there is an alternative to that solution, which is better than what I am building right now. So those were a few things which in college days mostly folks face. And they are not aware of building a venture because obviously they are coming from an academic background. So these things are pretty much existing in the college entrepreneurial ecosystem, that they do not know about actual venture building. They are just focusing on IPs, registering our companies, which are legal stuff, which matter like 1% or 2% in the startup world, but the problem and solution matter a lot. So that was the first problem that I faced during my college while trying to build a venture. And my initial failures were due to that reason as well, along with unawareness about the whole ecosystem.
Any suggestions for our viewers on how to work on their startup during their graduation time? And what are the important cautions that one should follow?
Being in this particular space for last few years, I understand that this is very subjective in terms of which venture they are building. If it is something which is a moonshot project, very much technical, then they require to validate their idea in a way if they will be able to build it or not, have some technological access to do R&D and all sort of things. But in a broader way, what matters is what is the problem they are trying to solve. If they have researched that problem properly, are they themselves facing that problem? If they are facing that problem themselves, then they can empathize with other folks who are facing that problem. The second thing is around what is the market size of this problem? Is it like just 10 people in the world facing that problem, or is it around 1 lakh or 2 lakh or even 10 lakh people facing that problem? Is that problem growing? Is it like 10 lakh people facing this problem today, but tomorrow it will grow up to 15, then 20? That's how the market size will increase. And the third thing is all around the solution. Whatever solution they are coming up with to solve this problem, does that matter? Is it actually solving that problem? And then moving forward with doing a small pilot of writing down their problem statement, whatever they are doing, then coming up with the solution, whatever the solution is there or in their brain, and trying to do a small pilot of maybe taking 10 users, giving them that solution and see if it works. If it eventually works in the initial days, it will go viral by itself through referrals. Those 10 users will bring in the next 20 users. Those 30 users will bring in the next 30 users, and it will eventually work. So rather than focusing on building a pitch deck, a business model, a patent, an IP, they can simply validate their problem and solution that they are assuming right now to be correct.
At present, you are working on Zartup. Can my viewers know much about Zartup?
At Zartup, we are solving a problem that I myself faced in my college days, during my initial days of entrepreneurship, that I wasn't aware of the lean model of building a startup. I wasn't aware of how to validate an idea. I was just aware of things which doesn't matter in the startup world, which are like legalities, registering, patent, and all sort of things. So we are trying to remove that barrier from someone's mind. If they are thinking about registering their startup, if they are thinking about registering their patent, they don't have to think about all those things. Startup takes care of all those things in general if it eventually works. So what we do is make the candidates laser focus on two things. Building a lean MVP. An MVP is something which is a minimum viable product or a solution that they assume to be correct. Shipping it to their users, launching it, and acquiring the initial 100 users. So it's like whatever they were assuming initially and trying to raise funds for, they can simply build it with zero funds, they can ship it, launch it to around 100 users and see if it works or not. If it eventually works, then it will go viral organically. They can raise funding because they already have traction. So that's what we are trying to do in the initial stages. And later on, if they succeed in gaining traction, making a good product, then we connect them with investors.
It is very interesting idea. Where do startup ideas come from and how to think about startup ideas?
The first thing is following the technology trend. If there is something happening in the blockchain space, if there is something happening in the, let's say, something which is a disrupting technology coming up, staying at the edge of that technology and following that trend helps in terms of thinking ideas on different sectors. The second thing would be around solving your own problem. In my case, the second thing worked because I'm not a technical guy. I'm a very non-technical person with a good business acumen. So in my case, it was all around solving my own problem. So initially, I saw a problem that when I was going for treks, I used to get my battery drained. I tried solving that. Second thing is that I had like bunch of startup ideas. I didn't know how to do market research. I tried solving that for different folks. Third thing was around workout tracking. So it was very much manual in the initial days. So I tried making it automated. The fourth thing was I realized that the startup ecosystem is living in assumptions. They are not executing ideas. So that's why I founded Startup. So it's all about solving your own problem that eventually works in the longer run, because we understand the other people who are facing the same problem. We can empathize with them. We can find out where they exist, get them as our customers and solve their problem. So these are the two things which worked in my case and which eventually works.
As per my knowledge, every idea may not be feasible. So how to validate startup ideas?
Validate startup ideas, if it is our own problem, then it is pretty easy because we understand that the problem exists in the market. It's all about figuring out multiple users who are similar to us. So let's take for an example, Juggler, which was a computer vision based fitness tracking application. The problem that we are solving was workout tracking was very much manual. To solve that, we came up with a computer vision based application which can automatically track workouts. To validate this idea, we went on to hiring some folks in college who are very good at computer vision. They helped us develop the initial MVP. One of my friends helped us assemble the whole application and we launched it. So focusing on executing from day zero helps. After launching this application, we didn't raise money to market this product. We simply approached people on Instagram who were uploading their fitness videos and asked them to download this particular app and get some rewards by downloading it, by using it. It started organically. They loved that particular product from the initial days itself. So the first thing would be around, if it is our own problem, we understand it. Then the second thing would be around executing it from the initial days itself. If it works, really good. If it doesn't work, then we can iterate or change the solution in some way or the other, because we already have users with us. We can empathize with them, understand their problem and solve it in some way or the other.
What are the challenges usually the founder will face in the initial stage?
Initial phases, founders fail the first and the foremost thing, and they give up pretty easily. That's what I have seen in bunch of folks who started with me during my journey at MarketGuard, WonderGuard, and Juggler itself. And this is pretty normal. If we see the journeys of entrepreneurs, they have failed eventually 30 times, 40 times in their journey, but they still kept up going. And that's how learning happens. Failure is just a feature in the entrepreneurial ecosystem, which helps us learn and do it in a better way. So eventually, not giving up is something which founders should be focused on from the initial days itself. If they are getting into entrepreneurship, then it is a long-term thing. It is not a short-term thing that in 2 years they'll build this and exit that. That doesn't work that way. If they're into this, then they have to have their skin into the game. The second thing will be around motivation. So entrepreneurship is always a lonely game. They may have like multiple co-founders, but still, if they are handling a particular department or particular stuff like sales or marketing or let's say development, it is always going to be a lone journey, first of all. So it's all about discovering your own truth, your own potential strengths, your own weaknesses, and understanding how to work better with your strength, how to play with your strength. The third thing would be around the surrounding. So the surrounding in India is not that supportive towards entrepreneurship. So obviously, the parents will say that don't do this, do a job because it is a secure option to do in India. Friends might be getting better job offers during the time you are struggling with building your own startup. Then it might happen that in life, you won't be getting bunch of opportunities which other folks are getting, like luxury and all sort of things. But in the long run, you are winning because you are understanding yourself better. You are understanding your strengths and weaknesses better and trying to work on your strengths. So these are the few problems that entrepreneurs or founders face in their initial stages. And if they get good guidance in terms of what is how to build something in a lean way, how to actually execute it rather than just procrastinating, then it eventually makes them learn multiple things and helps them grow.
I completely agree with all your points. Can my viewers know how to deal with failures that happen in a startup?
Failures happen in the early stage of building a startup multiple times. The thing is that accepting that you are not going to give up in a short run, accepting that failures will happen helps a lot. The second thing would be around accepting those failures and understanding what happened wrong. Because if you are failing for the first time in a particular problem, then it is fine. But failing multiple times with the same problem is a tragedy. So understanding what went wrong and trying to work on that. So in our case, in the first startup that we worked on was WonderGat. We weren't able to drive sales. So figuring out that sales is the problem. Then in our second startup itself, MarketGat, sales was a bit of a problem because of employee management. So sales was a big problem for us. So figuring out that how to drive sales, reading few books on that, how sales are driven, reading few case studies on that, talking to few people who are good at sales, helps us understand that this is what was our weakness, and now try to eradicate that whole weakness altogether. And we got pretty good in terms of marketing juggler, in terms of marketing startup in a broader way as well, just by learning through those failures. So failures are a feature, first of all. They help us understand the world in a better way, our weaknesses in a better way, and learn. So this is what I would say. If someone is failing, try to learn from those failures.
All your points are valid and very useful. According to me, failures are the stepping stone for success. Who is your favorite or inspirational startup founder?
It's a bit complex to say because I follow lots of entrepreneurs over here. But Eric Ries is someone whom I follow a lot. He is the builder of the Lean MVP model, or the Lean Startup book as well. He's an author. And the reason why I follow him a lot is how startups are built right now. In the traditional days, we used to believe that registering a company, patenting, and then getting into the market, hustling for a year or two will give us good opportunities or give us success. But he completely changed that model by making a lean model, which is all about talking to users from the initial days itself, validating the idea, and then working on giving a year or something. So this helped entrepreneurs in saving their 1 year or 2 year of time. So he's a role model in terms of how he articulated the lean startup model.
According to you, why executing a startup is more important?
So I take an anecdote from my own life while building my first startup, WonderGat. I procrastinated for almost a year that I'll build this. I focused on building a business model, pitch deck. But when I started executing it, I actually understood what my users want. So when we start executing our idea, then we get in touch with the real world, not in our assumed world that we have in our brain. So that's how it helps. And when we accept that failures are a common feature in the startup world, failing fast in the initial days itself will help us learn from those failures. So that is a very simple reason why execution helps in the longer run.
Can my viewers know what is the right time for a startup to go for funding?
Right after achieving product market fit. It's not at the idea stage that the startup founder should go for funding. Though I'll bifurcate it into two parts. First part would be a moonshot startup, which is into AI or computer vision space or something which is very complex in terms of technology and which requires huge capital investment in the initial days itself. That is fine. In that case, if the founders have that sort of background in terms of building technology or developing that product, they can go ahead with just an idea and a pitch deck to the investor saying that we need a minimum amount of capital to go ahead in the startup. But that is just the 5% of the startup ecosystem and the companies that we have in India. In rest 95% of the startups, if we see, they do not need capital in the initial days. They can simply have a website, have a simple logo. They can simply launch it with just 1,000 rupees or 1,500 rupees. If they are good at marketing, they'll achieve traction from the initial days itself. So when we talked about understanding the problem, understanding the users who are facing this problem, if they understand who are the users who are facing this problem, they can simply ship their website to these users, let them know that concept, what is they are solving for, let them use that product in the initial days itself. They do not require funding in the initial days at all. If the users are growing from that particular step of shipping a website or launching a product pretty fast, then they can go for funding because they have already achieved product market fit. And that is also in the case if they require funding. Like most of the startups in India are bootstrapped. If we see the startup ecosystem, we know the companies which are being funded by investors, but we don't know 90% of the companies which are not funded by any of the investors, which are bootstrapped. And there are a lot of companies in that space. So again, accepting the fact that wealth isn't a zero-sum game, anyone can create a startup, get customers and generate revenue out of it. It is not necessary to raise funding in the initial days at all.
What are the things an investor looks before investing in your startup?
Investors primarily look for a few things, like again, bifurcating this into two different spaces. First one is if there is something, a moonshot project, which is AI, computer vision based, forefront of a technology. Then they look for the market size, how it is growing, what is the new trend which is going to be over there. The second thing are lean startups, wherein it is something which is technology based. The founders have gained some traction in the initial days itself. So there are like very much different investment theses for all the VCs, all the angels as well. Though in general, they look for the founding team, first of all, how good are they? Second thing is all around what is the problem they are solving in the solution and the market size of this problem and the solution, which is going to be in the longer run. So these are the two things that primarily most of the investors look into, but it is very subjective because all of them have different investment theses in general. But if a founder is going for raising funds, they should have like some sort of traction, some sort of product market fit, just to showcase that we are actually pitching to raise funding and not just procrastinating right now.
Can you please explain available funding resources or investor groups in India?
For an early stage startup, there are like bunch of steps we can say. Let's define each of the steps. In a very early stage, it's all about having an accelerator or having an incubator to help them out. The second step becomes a pre-seed or seed round or maybe an angel round where they raise funding from some sort of investors. Then it becomes, they go to a seed round wherein they pitch to institutional venture capitals, and then moving forward series A, series B, series C sort of thing. So if we talk about just the initial stage of a startup, it's like investing your own money in the initial days, raising your friends and family round maybe, and achieving a benchmark, some traction, some users, good product market fit, maybe 100 or 200 customers in the initial days itself, helps the founders to pitch to a few angels or few early stage venture capitals. Which are the resources for this? To pitching angels, our ventures is a good platform wherein they have more than 2,000 angels, I guess. The second thing is all around the early stage venture capitals, like 100x VC has come up recently in India. Titan Capital is funding a few startups in the very initial stages. Few more resources will be reaching out to the angels directly. So if you see on LinkedIn, someone is an angel investor, so you angel investor, you have already achieved good traction or good customers in the initial days, then just striking a conversation with them on whatever you are building. They're always happy to have a meeting and understand what is the startup is doing when you have traction. So these are some resources that the initial in the initial days, the founders can follow. Apart from this, there are more global resources which are pretty good, like Y Combinator is one of the biggest accelerator in the world. They fund like around 100 startups every 6 months from India. So applying to Y Combinator is a pretty good option, because during their application process, also the founders understand a bunch of things where they are lagging behind. And apart from this, there are lots of talent investors which are coming into the market right now. Entrepreneur First is one of them, which helps you meet your technical co-founder or not non-technical co-founder in general. And they pay you for building a startup. It's like they pay around 1.5 lakh per month just to quit your job and join Entrepreneur First and build your own startup. Antler is another good resource. Right now, they have come to India in last 1 or 2 years. They're also a talent investor wherein they fund and incubate your startup, accelerate your startup in the initial days itself. Apart from that, there are a bunch of accelerators across India as well. Like there is a GAN network, which consists of India Accelerator and a few other accelerators that you can check. And Crunchbase is a really good resource to understand which are the funding resources available, which are the accelerators available across India. So just going to Crunchbase and screening on which are the accelerators based out of India, US, UK, something like that, and starting the application process.
I want to ask one question, which majority of my channel viewers want to know it. Few students are getting employment offers from both MNCs and startups. They are in confusion to choose the right one. Can you please explain them to clear their confusion?
Thanks for this question. So it would be a bit subjective and only from my personal experience and opinion, I would elaborate this. The first thing is that if they are getting an option from an MNC, they have to understand that it's a repetitive work that they'll be doing. They'll be at the bottom of this whole value chain that the MNC has built. So initially just helping a few seniors, few vice presidents across that organization, staying in an analyst or junior analyst role. That's what they'll be doing. But the learning will be from the organizational structure that the MNC has built. The repetitive work exists in an MNC because the organizational structure is pretty good. The reporting structure is pretty good. That's how they are very, very efficient with a very huge team of like 3 lakh people across the world and still managing them in a better way. But while working in a startup, it is very lean. So maybe they're directly working with a founder or reporting to someone who is very close to a founder. And the learning curve is pretty high because they work in a generalist role. So again, bifurcating it into two parts, someone who is looking for a generalist role and someone who is looking for a specialist role. Someone who is looking for a generalist role would be someone who likes marketing, who is still figuring out what is a good option for him, who likes marketing, sales, some sort of admin role, hiring, all sort of things. So for a generalist, startups role are pretty good when they are still figuring out what to work on, what they love to do in life. But someone who is a specialist, who has already figured out what to work on, like they love marketing or they love finance, they have already figured it out. Then working on an MNC makes sense because they'll be specializing in that particular part or that particular subject.
Thank you for your wonderful explanation. I hope this answer will clear their confusion. What is your future roadmap ahead for Zartup organization?
So at Zartup, we are trying to create a whole value chain for the early stage entrepreneurs who are still in college or who have started doing their job in their early stages of their job, and few entrepreneurs who are like pretty much matured. So for them, the initial problem that they face is in terms of validating an idea, making them validate that. And the second problem that they are facing is the surrounding that they have across India. We are solving for that. It's a very good surrounding within Zartup that they get to meet a bunch of interesting people who are building their startup, who are ambitious enough to work on their own. And then moving ahead at the bottom of this value chain, it's all about raising investment, building a big business. So that's what we are currently focusing on. We are building an angel network in which we are connecting few of the startups from our cohorts who have gained traction recently to raise funding, to get good sort of mentorship. So this is the whole value chain from the from an idea stage to raising funding and building a business. That's what we are trying to build.
It is very interesting to hear, Shubham. So your organization will help them who want to establish their own startup. In last 15 to 20 minutes, I have asked several questions related to your educational background, internships at IITs, and regarding startup. If I missed any question, can you please highlight it?
It was really nice talking with you, Jagdish. I think we covered all the aspects of for an early stage founders and few anecdotes from my life as well. So thank you so much for inviting me to this podcast and really nice having this conversation with you.
It is my pleasure, Shubham. This video will be very helpful for the people who are planning to establish their own startup. All your suggestions are very helpful. If anyone want to ask any questions to Shubham, feel free to post them in comment section. Either me or Shubham will answer them as early as possible. Thank you for watching the complete video. Have a nice day.